This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Abbreviations. ADM. Admiralty Papers. BT. Board of Trade Papers. C. Chancery Papers. CO. Colonial Office. DAV. Davenport Papers. HCA. High Court Papers. IOLR. India Office Library and Records. LRO. Liverpool Record Office. M. Merseyside Maritime Museum. NMM. National Maritime Museum. Place. Records of the Palatine of Lancaster. Pro. Public Record Office, former name of the National Archives. T. Treasury Papers. TNA. The National Archives. ZHC. Publications of the House of Commons, including some of the House of Lords. Introduction. As early as the 9th century, an Irish chronicle referred to blue men, Old Irish Fir Gormer, being brought in Viking longships to the British Isles from Morocco, and apparently settling for a while in Ireland. This strange description is still used in the Sahara, and derives from the deep blue indigo dye used to colour the voluminous cotton garments worn by such peoples as the Tibisti and Tuareg of North and West Africa, and in regions as far south as northern Nigeria. These garments, known as taubs in Nigeria, often coloured the skin of the wearer, hence the legend of the blue men. These early blue-clad African voyagers, few in number, can hardly be considered the beginning of a continuum of seafarers of African descent on British ships, but they nevertheless provide an evocative portent of the many black sailors who would serve Britain so well in the future, both in times of peace and in her hour of need. Black Salt, Seafarers of African Descent on British Ships, documents the history of seafarers of African descent over several centuries. It examines their work and experience in the British merchant and royal navies, from impressed slaves to free Africans, British West Indians, and also those African Americans who served on British ships prior to the independence of the American colonies. The book examines the contribution made by both ordinary and extraordinary black seafarers, from the earliest contact between Europeans and Africans to Britain's modern navy, focusing upon the lives of servicemen who did not always achieve recognition, but who nevertheless made Britain great. The voices of black seamen are traced through documents dating back to as early as 1547. Readers will embark upon a journey that allows them to witness at first hand the verbal testimony of black seamen such as Jack Francis, an African diver who gave evidence in court on the reclamation project that followed the sinking of King Henry VIII's ship, the Mary Rose. Other voices of early black sailors include that of Olorda Equiano, who served aboard ship on the Phipps expedition to the Arctic alongside the teenage Nelson. Black Salt avoids an over-dependence upon more recent cliometric, quantitative techniques or an outdated anthropological approach to the study of black people. Instead, contemporary narratives written or dictated by black seamen themselves have been sought, alongside the oral testimonies of living seamen. This book charts the history of seamen of African descent within broader socio-economic and historical contexts, such as the slave trade and the impact of various wars, including the Seven Years' War, the Napoleonic War, and the First and Second World Wars. Also examined are colonialism and post-war migration to the United Kingdom, the result of the seaborne diaspora of people of African descent that gives the term the Black Atlantic, coined by Paul Gilroy. The stories of black seafarers span the gamut of experiences, including tales of sorrow and tragedy, heroism, victory and triumph. There are other books that feature seamen of African descent, such as Emma Christopher's Slave Ship Sailors and Their Captive Cargoes, but even where they do consciously focus upon black sailors, most deal only with specific phases of their history. Emma Christopher, often cited in this book, concentrates on the slave trade, for example, and Tony Lane and Diane Frost both mainly on the 19th and 20th centuries. What is lacking is a dedicated work that provides an overview of black seafarers in British service through the ages. The nearest publication is W. Jeffrey Bolster's Black Jacks, African-American Seamen in the Age of Sail, which of course does not deal with British seamen. Black Salt is more comprehensive and detailed in its scope, and will, I hope, be the stimulus for further research in this area and contribute to the reclamation of the group narrative of the ancestors of black British people. In the History 2004 5th's Annual Report on Curriculum and Assessment, the Qualifications and Curriculum Authority, QCA, raised issues about the lack of attention paid to black and multi-ethnic aspects of British history in English schools. Following a comprehensive overhaul of the secondary school curriculum in 2008, a government briefing document by QCA stated that learning about black history was to become compulsory in secondary schools for the first time, in order to put immigration, the Commonwealth, and the legacy of the empire into a clear historical context to help pupils prepare for life in a diverse and multi-ethnic society. The revised history curriculum for pupils in England aimed to give a broader view of the subject. Too little attention is given to the black and multi-ethnic aspects of British history. The teaching of black history is often confined to topics about slavery and post-war immigration, or to Black History Month. The effect, if inadvertent, is to undervalue the overall contribution of black and minority ethnic people to Britain's past, and to ignore their cultural, scientific, and many other achievements. What followed was a contested debate about teaching so-called black history, some seeing it as a discrete subject not relevant to the vast majority of students who were not from ethnic minorities. One of the arguments was that an emphasis on black history unfairly and artificially distorted the past by exaggerating the influence of a few bit part players on British history. This debate led to one respondent arguing in the Times Educational Supplement Discussion Forum that if they were going to teach about the black sailors in the British fleet at the Battle of Trafalgar, this would only be a 10-second comment in the lesson before moving on to the more important stuff. What is interesting is that this correspondent was, in effect, admitting to his or her own lack of knowledge of any narrative associated with historical participants of African ancestry. Previous awareness of their presence may well have only been expressed in stark numerical terms. It is intriguing that black sailors in the British fleet at the Battle of Trafalgar should have been chosen as an example, for there is evidence that casts those seafarers in a variety of roles that deserve to be recounted in a manner that goes beyond simple numbers. In the section of this book dealing with the battle, seafarers of African descent are shown to have occupied roles ranging from ordinary participants doing their duty to key, even heroic players. Indeed, what is notable about the history of seafarers of African descent is their normality in covering the range of human circumstance. Similarly, the notion of black sailors being just a few bit part players does not stand much scrutiny, as even ordinary black tars played no less a part in the final successful outcome of the battle than their white shipmates. The phrase bit part is significant in suggesting that only heroes are important players in British history. Even if that is the case, and this notion is widely regarded as discredited and unnecessary by modern social historians, then black seafarers can be seen to have also fulfilled that role. This is not only true of Trafalgar, just one episode in the history of black sailors on British ships, but throughout the whole of their long association with the British Navy. If this negative perception is to be countered effectively in teaching British history, what is required is for the narrative of seafarers of African descent to be far more widely popularized, both collectively and individually. The search for this often elusive narrative, scorned as mere storytelling by some academic researchers who are inured to quantitative techniques, deserves to be as much a part of the armory as any other mode of inquiry. This is particularly true of the earlier phases of school education, in which narratives play an important part in the delivery of history. Viewed in this light, it is important that narrative is given as much academic weight as quantitative, clear metric approaches, whether to the study of seafarers of African descent or of any other group whose contribution has been hidden or neglected for historic reasons. As areas of the history of black people such as the slave trade have proved to be so contested and controversial, over recent decades, starkly statistical and scientific approaches to the human past using social science modeling and quantification have been considered to have more value by well-respected researchers. This view is based on the belief that a statistical approach is likely to have more lasting value than an emotive or passionate one, but it does have its own drawbacks. Many historians would see the split between archive-based research and theoretical models of history as being the fundamental division in the discipline, rather than one between quantitative techniques and narrative history. However, if arguments similar to those of the TS respondent above result from teachers and practitioners simply not knowing the role played by black people, in this case seafarers of African descent, then it would seem that there is a void to be filled that will not be addressed by merely knowing the numbers. This reader is not alone in having little knowledge of the narrative of people of African descent. Indeed, there is a history of such ignorance, a stark reminder of the theoretical underpinnings of empire. Otherwise highly respected academics have shown no more restraint in pouring scorn upon the very notion of Africans having any history at all. In his book The Rise of Christian Europe, the eminent historian Hugh Trevor Roper describes African history as the unrewarding gyrations of barbarous tribes, believing that before European or Arab invaders brought literacy and civilization, Africa had no history to speak of. Trevor Roper was, of course, expressing this view in 1964, but it would appear that otherwise well-educated people can still make such crass remarks now, without apparently seeing the logic that something that one does not know about might nevertheless exist. There appears to be not only a special case for committed historians to continue to engage in the discovery, compilation and collation of such fragmentary historiographies concerning black people as do exist, but also for the conservation of existing narratives and their dissemination. Gustav Ungerer's article, Recovering a Black African's Voice in an English Lawsuit, featured in this book, is an excellent example. It would seem that only then will people of African descent claim their place in history. This stress on the importance of narrative is, if anything, traditional, rather than being anything new. In 1979, the historian Lawrence Stone questioned the burgeoning social history movement, which was demanding a social science model of statistical analysis. Stone felt that there was also an alternative move in historiography, reverting back towards the narrative. His interpretation of narrative was to see it as a device organized chronologically, focusing on a single coherent story, and descriptive rather than analytical. Stone also felt that it was concerned with people rather than abstract circumstances, and dealt with the particular and specific rather than the collective and statistical. This approach could not be more relevant to the practical implementation of a methodology geared towards the reclamation of neglected areas of history, as exemplified by this study of black British sailors. A faddish over-reliance upon a single mode of inquiry is clearly unwise if the historian is committed to investigating all the available evidence. The early part of Black Salt covers the initial employment of black sailors and contact between African coastal seafaring nations and British ships that were forced to stand out to sea because of the inhospitable shoreline and poor harbours of the West African coast. The high mortality rates among European sailors caused British ships' captains to enlist local deckhands to replace fatalities, thus beginning the long maritime relationship between the people of the two continents. An alternative source of black sailors at that time were slaves pressed into service as bondsmen by their owners. One of the difficulties faced by early black sailors was the fact that initial African contact with Europeans ran concurrently with the slave trade. The dangers faced by early black sailors during the slave trade era were legion, and could range from being captured by enemy ships and sold in the Americas, to being sold by the captain of the ship on which they served upon completion of the notorious Middle Passage. Salaries and conditions for most seamen were poor, particularly during the 18th and 19th centuries, leading to men being impressed into the service. How did black sailors fare during this period? When the slave trade ended, slaves recaptured from the ships of nations still engaged in the trade were freed by the Royal Navy, but were often obliged to serve a period of impressment. Some of these freed Africans found their new situation a better option than slavery, and would sometimes find the security of employment with the possibility of a pension a compelling reason to accept a life at sea. The early part of this book also considers black seamen's employment prospects and the differences between the merchant and the royal navvies. Set against the background of the slave trade, an examination of the status of sailors of African descent sometimes offers surprises. This study looks at the promotion prospects of sailors of African descent and the existence or otherwise of a hierarchy within the body of African sailors on board ship. In spite of the problems faced by black sailors at a time when European perceptions of people of African descent were poor, there are examples of individuals who rose above the prevailing circumstances to achieve high rank in both the merchant marine and the Royal Navy. The slave trade and the employment of seafarers of African descent resulted in a far wider global distribution of black people. People of African ancestry could now be found on both the North and South American mainland and on the many islands of the Caribbean. This book considers black seamen from most British territories, as well as those who chose to follow their white shipmates home to Blighty. Black sailors were often signed off in British territories far from their native lands, where their settlement helped the steady growth of black populations in ports such as Liverpool, Cardiff, and London. The reader is offered a glimpse of everyday life in these ports, including the fate of ex-naval beggars and those black seafarers who were lucky enough to become Greenwich pensioners. The Victoria Cross was first awarded to a black seaman in 1859 for heroism during the Indian Mutiny, and others received medals for gallantry as the value of sailors of African descent was recognized following the mid-19th century. Seamen from the Caribbean and Africa served in both the merchant and royal navies, often giving their lives for what they now regarded as the mother country. As the empire expanded during the 19th and early 20th centuries, there were sailors from newer parts of the African diaspora under British rule. Increasingly, black seamen from South Africa and Somalia, as well as from non-British territories such as French protectorates in North Africa, were to be found on British merchant ships. The term black is restricted in this work to seamen whose origins lie on the African continent. Other racial groups of seamen from Britain's former overseas colonies, protectorates and interests, including Lascars, Chinese and Polynesians, have their own rich history and traditions. Despite similarities of experience, to adopt a wider politically black terminology in a catch-all manner would be to deprive seamen of African descent of having their story told with a particular focus. Nevertheless, this work does touch upon Lascars and Chinese sailors at points when their stories overlap with those of African descent. Changes in shipbuilding as a result of technological advances made during the period covered by this book had implications for the employment of seafarers of African descent. The advent of steam engines as a means of propulsion led to the assumption that the environment of a hot engine room would be more suited to African, West Indian, and other seamen from warmer climes. These innovations affected both the position and conditions of black seamen and their Lascar and Chinese shipmates, seldom for the better. The patriotism of sailors from the British black diaspora continued, but after the Second World War, a new wind of change was blowing as the empire began to disintegrate. The loss of a potential source of black sailors was offset, however, by the now burgeoning black communities in many British cities. More than any other group, sailors have helped to found black settlements in Britain, as reflected in the chapters dealing with the ports during the 19th and 20th centuries. The concluding section of this book deals with the descendants of those first seamen, now black British as a result of that relationship, who continue to serve Queen and country to the present day. Black Salt has been written to shine some light upon a group of people who should be remembered for their achievements, and to demonstrate to the wider community that seafarers of African descent have contributed to both the British Royal Navy and Merchant Marine over a long period. This book may also act as an inspiration by providing black youngsters with positive role models, possessed of an astonishing degree of endurance, bravery and, not least, patriotism towards the nation to which they chose to give their allegiance. Setting the time parameters of this book has not been easy. Seafarers of African descent have served on British ships for a very long time. Just how long is difficult to say, as identifying firsts is fraught with difficulty owing to the hidden nature of the history, not only of the black British community, but of the black diaspora in general. Similarly, the decline of British commercial shipping is equally unhelpful as a point of conclusion, since sailors of African descent, British-born black, along with recent economic migrants, continue to serve in the senior service in the defence of the realm as well as on merchant vessels. As the chronological sweep of this study is so broad, a timeline of relevant events mentioned in the book has been provided as a general guideline to the reader. Some elements in the history of seafarers of African descent cannot be confined to a particular day or even year, but rather are changes that affected their employment over long periods of time. Examples would be the gradual restriction to working below deck after the change to steam, or the way in which pseudo-scientific racism impinged upon the lives of black sailors. For this reason, a timeline can only deal with chronologically situated events, but nevertheless it can offer vital markers in the history of these loyal servicemen. Timeline. 9th century. Blue men brought to the British Isles from Morocco. 1547. Jacques Francis, a Guinea diver, is employed on the reclamation of the Mary Rose. 1623. England establishes its first Caribbean colony at St. Kitts. 1660. The Company of Royal Adventurers trading to Africa, later the Royal African Company, is granted a charter giving a monopoly over the English slave trade. 1702. The Royal African Company orders enslaved young Africans for use on the company's ships, known as privileged Negroes. 1745. Alistair Equiano, an enslaved seaman and later author and abolitionist, is born. 1763. The floating anchor invented by a black seaman is first used on British ships. 1772. The Mansfield Judgment frees the black slave James Somerset, after which seamen of African descent serving in the Royal Navy are afforded greater protection. 1777. Admiral George Young's order limits the numbers of black recruits on Royal Naval vessels in the Caribbean to just 4 per warship. 1782. American black loyalists begin arriving in Britain. 1785. Dick and Will mutiny. 2 black seamen lead a mutiny on the slave ship Amity. 1787. Black colonists sail for Sierra Leone on the 9th of April, funded by the Committee for the Relief of the Black Poor. 1797. John Perkins, Jamaican-born, rises from obscurity to the rank of post-captain, possibly the first British captain of African descent in the Royal Navy. 1805. Battle of Trafalgar. 15% of Nelson's sailors are from overseas, at least 10 of HMS Victory's crew alone being of African descent. 1807. British Act for the Abolition of the Slave Trade. 1811. African-American ship's Captain Paul Cuff arrives in Liverpool with an all-black crew. 1815. William Brown, a black Barbadian woman, serves as a sailor on HMS Queen Charlotte in the Royal Navy. 1819. Anti-slave trade squadron. Liberated Africans begin to be recruited into the Royal Navy. 1833. Slavery Abolition Act ends slavery in British territories. 1838. The paddle steamer Sirius makes the first Atlantic crossing under continuous steam power, with implications for the changed role of black sailors. 1841. The Ethiop, a wholly African crewed ship, rescues HMS Albert on the Niger expedition. 1859. William Hall, 1827-1904, becomes the first black Royal Navy recipient of the Victoria Cross. 1887. Nigeria establishes the Lagos Marine Service. 1910. Committee on Distressed Colonial and Indian Subjects. Parliamentary inquiry finds that 3 in 5 distressed black people are seamen. 1911. Havelock Wilson, the leader of the British Seamen's Union, fights for the right of white British seamen to serve in British vessels, in preference to black or Asian seamen or seamen from other foreign countries. 1914. First World War. Black seamen constitute an important element in the Navy, specifically engaged in performing work deemed unsuitable for their white shipmates. 1917. The troopship SS Mendi is sunk in the English Channel, carrying the last South African Native Labour Corps of the war. 1917. Official recognition of the Merchant Navy. An Act of Parliament is passed, allowing for the voluntary adoption of a standard uniform, similar to that of the Royal Navy. 1919. Black British seamen protest against being cheated by the Ministry of Labour's Employment Department. Unemployed black seamen of British nationality are kept in ignorance of their rights. Severe rioting breaks out in May with white rioters attacking black people in their own homes. 1920. Bravery of seafarers of African descent recognised by British government. An order in council at the court at Buckingham Palace on the 3rd of December grants gratuities to men of colour entered under naval non-continuous service engagements. 1920. Aliens Order. 1925. Special Restriction Coloured Seamen Order. Pressure by the Seamen's Union results in the Home Office obliging African, Asian and West Indian seamen, citizens of the Empire, to register with the police as aliens. 1940. Colour bar in the Royal Navy during the Second World War. An instruction by the Director of Naval Recruitment bars coloured men residing in England from the Royal Navy. 1942. British-born blacks also barred from the Royal Navy. Foreign Office advises the British Embassy in the United States to refuse resident colonial patriots applying to join the British Armed Forces. 1942. 18 African seamen strike. Refusing to withdraw their demands for higher pay, the seamen are found guilty by Liverpool magistrates of disobeying the master's lawful commands and jailed. 1942. African-American servicemen begin to arrive in Britain. 1946. SS Princesa strike. Black seamen protest against appalling conditions aboard a merchant navy ship bringing meat from Argentina. 1948. Jamaican workers disembark at Tilbury Dock from SS Empire Windrush. Immigrants are welcome to meet the labour shortage in Britain. 1948. SS Orbiter and SS Reina del Pacifico bring 180 new settlers to Liverpool in October. 1955. Black freedom movement accelerates. This becomes far more widespread than in the United States, spreading to the entire black diaspora including Sailortown, Britain. 1959. Ghanaian Navy established. 1959. Nigerian government establishes its own shipping lines. 1960. Harold Macmillan gives his Wind of Change speech. 1964. Nigerian Navy established. 1976. Race Relations Act marks a gradual improvement in opportunities for black British seamen in both the Royal and the Merchant Navies. 1979. Sierra Leonean Navy established. 1989. Lieutenant CDR Neville Bryce becomes Chief of Boat in Royal Navy. 1996. Gambian Navy established. Chapter 1. Worlds Collide. In many African religions, death is not seen as ending the life or personality of an individual, but merely as a change in a person's condition. Those who have died continue to live on in their community, communicating and helping their families as invisible but very real entities, the core of the African concept of ancestors. Over the centuries, seafarers of African descent serving in both British maritime services found themselves in a similar role to that of their own departed forebears in becoming an unseen presence, at least in terms of being an often unacknowledged or unrecognized part of maritime life. Yet black British sailors were there, revealed by the practiced eye of the maritime artist in numerous paintings. 19th-century artists such as Daniel Maclise, Dennis Dicton and Andrew Morton show sailors of African descent engaged alongside their shipmates in the everyday shipboard toil, in a way that many historians do not. Nearer our own time in the history of black seafarers, the camera has had the same facility, showing the reality of naval life as though a lens filter had been fitted that allows us to view an otherwise invisible presence. Just as Africans have traditionally believed that they could interact and communicate with their ancestors, so we can find seafarers of African descent on British ships in past centuries if we try. We do not have to try too hard. Columbus's discovery of America in 1492 brought about the greatest expansion of Europeans into the rest of the world since the Vikings streamed out of their fjords 7 centuries earlier. The resulting white diaspora in the newly discovered western lands was soon followed by a second, black diaspora, as the failure of both white and Native American slavery caused European settlers to look elsewhere for a labor force to work the land acquired from the indigenous peoples. Europeans looked to Africa as a new source of manpower, thus beginning a relationship between Africa and Europe that was far closer than any previously held. The initial interaction between Africans and the British Navy was undoubtedly brought about by the slave trade, either directly or indirectly. The historian James Walvin argues that British involvement with black Africans does not date from the importation of black slaves into England, and that an examination of the earlier and wider history of European explorations and discoveries is important. It was contact with other European powers that brought Africans as visitors to Britain more than half a century before England had begun trafficking in slaves. A black court musician of Henry VII, John Blanquet, an ironical corruption of the French Blanc White, is recorded in 1507 around the time a group of Africans also reached the court of James IV of Scotland. In 1555, John Locke, the son of a prominent London merchant, brought to England Bin, Anthony and George from Sharma on the Gold Coast, now modern Ghana, with the intention of taking them back to Africa as interpreters for trading purposes. The Portuguese had been involved in the slave trade for over 100 years when an Englishman, Chilon Hawkins, following John Locke's lead, developed Britain's first generally recognized exploratory venture into the sale of human beings in 1562-3. Hawkins traded his slaves in the Spanish-held Caribbean island of Hispaniola, now Haiti and the Dominican Republic, in exchange for hides, sugar, ginger, and other commodities, a lucrative enterprise that led to other British adventurers seeking their own fortunes on the high seas. African slaves were sold in the Caribbean and the Americas through what is known as the triangular trade, which began with ships setting sail from British ports and buying or, in some cases, capturing young Africans on the West African coast. They would then embark upon the infamous Middle Passage, sailing from the African coast to the West Indies, with Barbados as often as not one of the prime destinations, acting as a clearinghouse for the rest of the Caribbean and North America. It was during this middle passage that most of the fatalities occurred, as slaves were packed tight in appalling conditions, and ships' captains were not above throwing their human cargo overboard in order to collect the insurance if it was found that the price they would achieve had dropped in the Caribbean. When the ships arrived and the slaves were auctioned to the plantation owners, the captains would then load up with a cargo of goods and commodities from the Caribbean which could be sold back in Britain. If the beginning of the transatlantic slave trade offers at least a plausible date for Britain's initial point of contact with African peoples, the trade was also a ready source of future black sailors, both free and unfree. These included Africans who chose a life at sea of their own free will, black people of the wider black diaspora, brought about by slavery who had managed to regain their freedom, those forced into service by the nefarious practices of the press gangs, and those slaves whose owners wished to provide them with alternative employment aboard ship rather than plantation or household duties. An early African voice. It was during this period of contact that an African with seafaring connections is recorded as being in British waters, some 15 years before Hawkins embarked on his expedition. In July 1547, the slave Jacques Francis, described as a Guinea diver from Arguin Island off the coast of Mauritania, was hired by the Admiralty along with his Venetian master Piero Paolo Corsi to help salvage the wreck of Henry VIII's famous warship, the Mary Rose. This task, however, was to prove much more complicated, as a legal argument arose between Corsi and a group of Italian merchants that led to Jacques Francis being called to the witness stand in an English court. On the 19th of July 1545, a French invasion fleet commanded by Admiral Claude d'Arnabo entered the Solent with the intention of destroying the English fleet and invading the Isle of Wight. The crew of the Mary Rose were possibly overzealous in engaging the enemy, as she appears to have tacked too sharply, causing water to rush in through the lower deck gunports of the overladen ship. The king watched, no doubt horrified, as his warship sank within a few minutes, taking with her 400 seamen and soldiers. One of the first English warships to mount heavy cannon, she was carrying 181 smaller guns of various types along with other goods. Lying in 6 fathoms of water even at low tide, the task of recovery was considered to be a job for foreign specialists. The salvage partnership initially chosen by Lord High Admiral John Dudley, Viscount Lisle, were Italians Piero de Andreasi and Simone de Marini, both living in Southampton. With the help of a team including 30 Venetian mariners, a carpenter and 60 English mariners, the Italians made 2 unsuccessful attempts to raise the Mary Rose, but gave up having recovered only her rigging. The 2 Venetians responsible for salvaging the ship were paid off on the 8th of December 1545. Later in 1546, another Venetian, Piero Paolo Corsi, Peter Paul, and his salvage team were appointed by the Admiralty, which although resigned to the loss of the Mary Rose was still keen to recover whatever guns it could from the wreck, since ordnance was an expensive new technology. Corsi had bought the 20-year-old Jacques Francis from a local Italian merchant, realizing that, in order to meet the requirements of the contract, he needed a first-class diver. Francis was to be the head diver of the new team of expert salvage operators, which included John Ito, George Blake, Blackie, and 2 other unnamed teammates. As such, he was an important witness in the court case that resulted from an accusation against his employer, Corsi. The former salvage team claimed that Corsi had stolen blocks of tin belonging to them from 2 other wrecks, the Sancta Maria and Sanctus Edwardus, as well as nautical instruments made specifically at Portsmouth for obtaining gear from the Mary Rose. As Corsi's lead diver, the choice of Francis as a witness on his master's behalf is unsurprising, but something of a dispute arose over the legality of his appearance in court. Given the times when there were difficulties in coming to terms with the racial ambiguities generated by the presence of black Africans, the line taken by the Italian claimants is not surprising. The original salvage team was strongly prejudiced against Francis's presence in court, being from a country with a long tradition of dealing with black slaves and servants. They were adamant that the Guinea diver was merely an uncivilized man, a slave, a bondsman, a black Moor, and an infidel to boot, which made him ineligible to appear in court. The Admiralty judges, on the other hand, seemed ready to acknowledge his humanity as a person who was obviously in a position to know the details of exactly what had happened over the matter of the misappropriated articles from the wrecks. The court appears to have paid no attention to the claims of the first Italian team, and with caution, Jacques Francis may well be the first black witness in an English court of law to give first-hand evidence in such a keenly contested lawsuit. It could be that one reason why the High Court of Admiralty in London did not support the Italian plaintiff's view was that when Jacques Francis appeared, he was hardly the figure they had expected to see and hear. The witness that the Londoners of Edward VI's reign saw was a black African dressed in European clothes, highly articulate, and fully capable not only of responding to the accusations made against his employer, but of dealing with issues of his own black identity and humanity. Another factor that may have encouraged the court's sympathy was that the Admiralty was by no means ungrateful for the recovery of some of the expensive ordnance from the Mary Rose, the salvage of which had become something of an issue of national pride. Francis's testimony affords us the rare voice of a very early African sailor in terms of contact with Europeans, and most unusually, given the period and the fact of his slavery, in his own words. Unfortunately, his testimony was not given in English but was translated from Portuguese or the Fala da Guiné, a patois Portuguese spoken by most Africans in Portugal by a John Tyrwhitt. The Guinea diver testified before the judges of the Admiralty on the 8th of February 1548 that about Easter 1547, with his master and seven more men, he happened to find in the sea at the Needles, off the west coast of the Isle of Wight, a bell and 200 blocks of tin and lead. Upon handling, they were found to be perished and forsaken. Francis explained that as his master had a commission from the Lord Admiral for reclaiming purposes, various instruments and equipment were prepared at a cost of 300 crowns. He pointed out to the court that, if anything, his master had cause to complain about the allegations leading to Corsi's arrest in Southampton, as they prevented the team working during an ideal time of the year. And by that means the complainant kept the said Peter, that he could not vse his feet in tacking veep thereof by the space of all the month of May, the best time that he shulled haue by and occupied. And by reason thereof his instrumentes and vitels so prepared were not occupied, and by that means lost the said tin, bell and leather. Francis assessed the cost to his master as being some £700. Although Jacques Francis achieved an apparent legal recognition of the incipient black presence in early modern England, it came far too early to have any lasting consequence upon negative attitudes towards black Africans as their numbers in England increased during the next century. He nevertheless succeeded in upsetting the European notion, even at that early stage of interaction between black and white, that a black African could not be articulate, cultured and even capable of acquiring skills not available to English competitors. Worth remembering is that English law is built upon precedents, and in the latter half of the 18th century the abolitionists would have to dig deep to find formal evidence of precisely this sort, that a black person might be considered a fellow human being. Jacques Francis was perhaps trying to present his relationship with his master in a favourable light when he told the judges that he was Piero Paolo Corsi's familius, rather than a service. 20 years service was a person captured and put to work, while a familius was a slave member of the household, often thought to be a better position as the term invoked an older meaning in Italian society that included all family members, both slave and free. In other words, a familius was considered a member of the family. The fact that Francis was a slave directly from Africa may have coloured his assessment of his own situation. In West Africa, free labour services could be imposed upon on certain groups and individuals, who might arrive at their servile condition through conquest, capture in war or as a punishment for crime. Frequently they would be peasants whose status differed little in essence from that of the serfs or villeins of medieval Europe, and who were regarded as inseparable from the land they tilled. This use of tied or wageless labour undoubtedly increased after the 15th century, mostly in the Muslim areas of Western Sudan. These wageless workers were seldom, if ever, mere chattels, men without rights or hope of emancipation, as was the norm in most transatlantic forms of slavery. Under African forms of slavery they could be bought and sold, given away and accepted as gifts. However, their condition was different from that of African chattel slaves of the Americas, in that they were not considered outcasts from the body politic. Household slaves lived with their masters, often as family members, integral members of their community who could work themselves free of their obligations. In some cases, they could marry their masters' daughters, they could become traders, governors, and sometimes even kings. An old Asante proverb stated, "A slave who knows how to serve succeeds to his master's property." In transatlantic slave societies, particularly in the West Indies and the United States, a hierarchy emerged among slaves. The position of house slave, which was often associated with skills ranging from hairdressing to acting as an amanuensis, was frequently considered to have a greater dignity than plantation work. It may be that Francis was trying to say that he was considered a valued member of Corsi's team, and not the equivalent of an unskilled deckhand. In spite of his apparently rare skills, Francis was nevertheless still a slave, liable to be bought and sold. When the rival salvage team partner Domenico de Molaines claimed that Francis had been slave and bondman to the Sade Petto Paolo, he hardly made a distinction between the two terms. Indeed, for Francis as a black man, they were one and the same. The difference between a slave and a bondsman did matter, however, depending upon skin color. In the Americas, slavery began with white as well as Native American slaves.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.